My name's Peter Harris, and I take the corporate tax module in the MCL. And I've been teaching corporate law and corporate tax law for a long, long time, more than 20 years. And this particular course is sort of based on something I have been teaching in various countries. It's not just, you know, actually I haven't really had the opportunity until the MCL started to teach this sort of course here in Cambridge. So I've been teaching it for about 15 years. And I won't bore you with anything further, but I do act as an external consultant for the IMF, and I've assisted developing countries in drafting tax laws, and that's sort of adds to the sort of perspective of where I actually come from on these issues. We're going to concentrate here not on the detail, but on the big picture. Yeah, and I want to get that across clearly, because you know, you say the word corporate tax, and people get a bit scared. There's certainly not any. Any needs to have any existing knowledge here with respect to taxation itself. And if you have some, that's fine. If you don't, it's not necessary. Rather, what I'm more interested in and what I think is more important is what you're actually here for, which is that you have some sort of basic knowledge of corporate law, and especially because of the nature of corporate tax, you know, some basic financing techniques and stuff, you know, in corporate law. In the corporate field. So that's, that's from there, what I want the purpose of the course to be, as it says in the course outline, is to just look at the way in which corporate law actually impacts on corporate behaviour and corporate decision making. I don't have to tell you, I suspect, how topical that is at the moment, especially in the context of what's been going on with the multinationals. We won't get to that level of detail, although I do sort of teach that sort of stuff in a general course in the LLM, so we can talk bits and pieces on the side about it, about the multinationals and what's been going on with them shifting profits all around the place. Rather, what's more interesting from this perspective, I think, is the way in which the corporate tax laws themselves have actually influenced the process of the actual decision making in the context of the actual boardroom. Recently, the last hoo-ha, which is much closer to sort of what this course is about, has been the Tax Justice Network, who is one of the pressure groups who started all the sort of publicity about the multinationals not paying enough tax and all the public inquiries in the US and the UK that have been going on about this. They've actually also released a paper which says that, for example, directors have no fiduciary duty to their company to minimise their tax. That's a quite nice controversial thing to say, isn't it? So at least in the tax area, there's a bit of discussion about whether that's right or whether that's wrong or how that should be approached. But one thing is absolutely clear is that at least from the revenue authorities' perspectives, there is certainly a lot more push to get tax on the agenda in the boardroom. That one is absolutely clear. And it's nearly at the end of the day, it all comes back to risk profile, I think, more than anything. And what you and what the courts companies are willing, how much risk they're willing to take with respect to their tax profile. Anyway, how are we actually going to approach this course? Well, as I've said, the idea is to focus on the actual decision making, how tax impacts on decision making and behaviour of companies. And so we're going to actually structure it around, or at least focus on, particular corporate law issues, yeah, and their tax consequences. That's the idea. The thing that we do not do in this course at all is focus on generic tax issues, things that are just generic to profits taxation, which is what we actually focus on, yeah? And so we always are picking up sort of areas of corporate law where there's a question as to whether or not tax law actually accepts the corporate law approach or it doesn't. The bottom line with tax law is, it's one of the reasons why it's so complicated is that if you are going to attach tax consequences to the behaviour of companies or individuals or anything for that matter, then of course you have to have a framework in which to analyse what's actually happened, and so you can characterise it for tax purposes. Rightly or wrongly, tax law has to start with the general law position. Yeah? You can't rewrite in a tax law the entire law of the whole country for tax purposes. Yeah? You have to accept that, you know, an employee is as you actually define it for employment purposes. A company, you start with the question, a company is as you would define it for corporate law purposes. A dividend is what you would say it is for corporate law purposes. A share is what you would say it is for corporate law purposes. The complications with tax law is that it then starts to question whether or not those general law rules and characterizations are acceptable for tax purposes. And so We are forever questioning, and corporate law is probably the worst case scenario of this, and this is why tax laws get so complicated, is because the tax law just does not accept the corporate law position, and it moves on from it. Yeah, and so it's there is this sort of, you know, interface and clashing between corporate law and tax law, and that's what this course is about. It's about that interface and the extent to which tax law actually does not accept what you might find is a standard treatment for corporate law purposes. I'll come back to some specifics about that in a minute, but that's what it's about. And I think what we're going to do is we focus around some basic problems. I think there's about seven problems just to keep our attention focused, and we just use those as discussion in class, and that's what we actually focus on. Within that context, the course then takes a comparative approach, and that sort of just is because of, you know, what I'm used to teaching anyway. And it also explains that we are going to keep it at a pretty high level, so we're not going to get bogged down in too much detail. It'll get complicated anyway, but you know, we won't descend into so much detail that we can't get back out again. So we're going to look at comparatively, the US, the UK, and Germany. Yeah? And they're the three countries that actually, they have sort of archetypal systems within tax law, in the sense that most countries around the world have a system that looks like one of their systems. Yeah, that's what we're going to, that's the general approach. Within that, down to more specifics, the main theme of the course is no surprise. Corporations, of course, and why you're here is because, you know, they are artificial at some level. And it's exactly that problem that is the critical thing in tax law. And that's when tax law starts to, you know, the big question for this course is, when does tax law effectively lift the corporate veil in whole or in part, or it just doesn't accept that the corporation is entirely separate? Those are the big questions in tax law. And they're the things we're going to focus around. And there are three primary artificialities here for tax law purposes. Yeah? And the first one is, when a corporation derives income, is the tax law really going to believe that that's the corporation's income? Now, there are some definitional problems here. You know, how does the tax law define what a corporation is or a company is, depending on the terminology, and what's the relationship between the general law characterization? That's one issue. That's not really the issue we're going to focus on, but we have to start there. Second one is, how does it actually calculate its profits? You already have to, in most countries, at least for some purposes, report profits, usually according to accounting principles. How does the tax law interface with that legal requirement under corporate law, and to what extent are those accounts actually accepted or not? And again, just to the general law approach, you know, what's the relationship between accounting treatment and the actual tax law? So we look at that, and there's a lot of difference of approach between the three countries in that, which gives us a good feel for how countries approach this. And then finally, what the thing I want to concentrate then is the area where we see the biggest questioning of the separate identity of corporations in tax law is when we get to corporate groups. And so we want to then have a look at corporate groups, and we want to actually have a look specifically at how the tax law treats corporate groups. One thing, just to give you one very clear example. There is no such thing, you know, you are just not going to take the consolidated accounts and treat them for tax law purposes as the accounts of one single consolidated entity for tax purposes. That doesn't happen in any country at all. Yeah? So that's a good example of how you can actually divorce, or what the sort of questions are about the relationship between corporate law and the obligations that come under corporate law and tax law, and that's what we're about. The second artificiality is when a company starts to distribute dividends. Dividends are very different from other sources of income in tax law, because they were already a source of income. They were the corporation's source of income. And yet, bizarrely, every country says that dividends are a separate source of income from the corporation's actual profits. Even the word dividend, to divide, says that that's not true. So how does the tax law, number one, define what is a dividend and what is not? Because that's absolutely critical in calculating the corporation's income. So we get into the whole debt equity sort of issues there. How do you distinguish between debt and equity? And again, we're going to see that every tax law has something to say which is not consistent with general law. They override the general law characterization of shares or debt, and they will tell you that something that is actually a share is debt, or vice versa. Yeah? And they won't accept the general law characterization. So, you know, we're going to look at the approaches there. Again, not get in too much detail, but look at the actual issue. That's one issue with respect to the distribution of dividends. The second one is the double taxation issue. The corporation's profits were already taxed. How are dividends taxed? Yeah, that just shows very clearly the artificiality of the corporation. And you know, the question is then, what does the tax law actually do about that? What we call economic double taxation? Yeah, taxation of corporate profits, taxation of the dividend. So that's the second artificiality. So a corporation as an entity that derives income is one, just questioning the actual separate personality of the corporation. The separate identity of dividends as an actual source of income, that's number two. The third artificiality that we actually focus on, not surprisingly, are shares as a separate asset from the assets of the corporation themselves. We get this, you know, crazy sort of, you know, if you are familiar with corporate law and you've heard of the problem of duplication of losses, you know, for recovery purposes, you know, recovery at the corporate level as well as do you have a shareholder action to recover for a wrong done as well. And we, you know, some countries have talked about the duplication. You can't recover twice. You can't recover at the corporate level and at the shareholder level at the same time for the same wrong that's been done. I can promise you that is nothing compared to what happens when you get into tax law. Because in tax law, all of the assets are duplicated. Yeah, all of the assets at the corporate level are duplicated in the value of the shares. And the tax law is opposed, even though one, they're tied together, you know, the valuation is tied together, the tax law has to actually track both assets and make sure that there's not a lot of manipulation going on here. And if you start to create corporate chains, that just gets worse and worse and worse. You know, the classic scenario I will give you is where somebody starts out with £100 or dollars worth of cash, contributed to a company. Now there's two assets, the shares worth 100 and the actual company still got the 100 in cash. That company then contributed in return for shares to another company, so you've got another $100 worth of cash, and it just goes on and on and on. And the tax law has to track all of these different types of assets which just reflect each other, when really there's only $100 in cash in the first place. That's the only asset there actually is. So, you know, again, you know, all this does is just re-emphasize, once again, the artificiality of corporations and the interests in them. And then the question is, how does the tax law actually respond to these artificialities? And like as I say, I promise you, they just don't follow corporate law. Because if they did, they would just get, the tax system would be worse than it actually is now. Yeah. So they're the sorts of issues that we will be following. I think for more detail, you can actually look in the materials, in the handbook, and it gives you a better breakdown. The classes are, I think, a little bit different from other classes, because I actually do this in four-hour sessions. Because I could, once the MCL started. But also, I think it's really interesting. I do actually longer sessions in some other universities than 4 hours. And actually, last year's four-hour sessions worked really, really well. And what they do is they give you continuity. They give you an ability to start and then not have to stop discussion at any, you know, after 4 hours everybody's exhausted anyway. But, you know, it does give you that sort of continuity and that flow. So we start on the 25th of October, and then we run for 4 weeks from there. And I think that sort of timing this year, it works a lot better than it did last year, because then you've got 28 days before the exam. So, we finish on the 15th of November. There's time for a revision session at some point, which we'll negotiate when we do that, and then it's onwards to the exam on the 12th of December. The exam is open book, and there'll be four questions, and you have to answer two in 2 hours. It's the same format as last year. Look at the format on the webpage for the subject and the last year's exam. It'll be the same. You won't get a question on the specifics of any particular country's tax system. That's not what the nature of the course is about. It's about you understanding the manner in which tax law can impact on corporate law decision making. There is a text, and that's really easy. And essentially, this text is historically, it's the verbatim production of my lecture notes for this subject and more. Yeah, so you don't really need anything more than this text. And in addition, you can take this text expressly into the actual exam with you. Yeah. So this is not about, there's no memory element in this. This is just going to be about, and if you do the reading, you'll get the most out of this course if you do the reading before the class, and then that enables us to do a lot of discussion in the class and just check exactly how much did you understand, which are the more important bits and which bits are not. Yeah. So that's what you need. Of course you can take in slides and handouts and reading lists and stuff into an opening book exam as well. I think I'll leave it at that. I mean, there's, you know, all the usual questions. Do I need to know any tax? I think I've answered that. Is it hard? Well, I'm going to take it as gently as possible. How would you find out more? Well, have a look at the I've already uploaded some of the slides and the reading list to the webpage for this subject, and there is also the introductory first 16 or 17 pages from this book that's actually there electronically, which you can have a look at to try and help you make your decision. And of course, if you've got, will I take questions now, or I'll just answer any questions at coffee, Brian?
If you're here for coffee, then why not? So then Peter can
move on. Yeah, let's do that. So I'll answer any questions at coffee.